Good evening. I welcome you again to the next in the ongoing lecture series on women's intimate health by Dr. Ragini Agrawal and Indian Academy of Cosmetic Dermatology and Gynecology. This webinar is organized in association with Gorakhpur Obstetrician and Gynecology Society. On behalf of Jaxonpal Pharmaceuticals Limited, makers of JP Tone Syrup, Cyclorex CR10 and Endorec Tablet, I'm Dr. Vipin Tyagi, along with my teammates, Dr. Deepika Chhabra and Mr. Amit Saxena. For today's discussion on puberty issues today, we welcome the host and moderators, Dr. Ragini Agrawal, National Vice President FOCSI, President IACDG, and Founder Chair Aesthetic Health Committee of IMS. And Dr. Amrita Sarkari Jaipuriar, Vice President Gorakhpur Obstetrician Gynae Society. We are thankful to ICOG for the accreditation of one ICOG point to all attendees of the webinar today. We feel honored to have alongside a galaxy-studded medical luminaries to enlighten us today, Chief Guest Dr. Radha Jina, Patron, Indian Menopause Society, Gorakhpur Branch, Patron, Gorakhpur Chapter, ISOPAR, Guest of Honor, Dr. Swasti Singh, Founder President, Azamgarh Obstetrician Gynae Society, President IMA Azamgarh, and Dr. Kusum Verma, President Mau Obstetrician Gynae Society. We thank all the esteemed chairperson for sparing your valuable time to impart words of wisdom to all. Dr. Seema Pandey, President Azamgarh Obstetrician Gynae Society, and Dr. Madhubala Sharma, President Gorakhpur Obstetrician Gynae Society. To enlighten us on this topic, we welcome speaker of the day, Dr. Chandan Kachru, Obstetrician Gynae and Adolescent Health Specialist, W. Pratiksha Hospital, Gurugram, Chairperson Udaan Project, Harop Gynae. In the panel, we have Dr. Ashima Dabas, Pediatric and Adolescent Endocrinologist, MAMC, and Loknayak Hospital, Delhi. Dr. Ekika Singh, Secretary, Mau Society. Dr. Poonam Dixit, Chairperson, Imaging Committee, Patna Obstetrician Gynae Society. Dr. Reena Srivastav, Ex-Professor and Head, Obstetrician Gynae, BRD Medical College, Gorakhpur. President, Gorakhpur Menopause Society. Dr. S. Sampath Kumari, Professor, Obstetrician Gynae, Government, Thiruvanmalai Medical College and Hospital. Dr. Upma Jaiswal, Obstetrician Gynae Sonologist, IVF Specialist, Swastik Marigold Hospital, Gorakhpur. Dr. Usha Singh, Secretary, Basti Obstetrician Gynae Society, Vice Chairman, Mission Pink Health. Vote of thanks and Q&A session by Dr. Archana Messi, Secretary, Azamgarh Obstetrician Gynae Society, Dr. Meenakshi Gupta, Secretary, Gorakhpur Obstetrician Gynae Society. Welcome to all attendees. Please post your queries by text in the Q&A box to be answered at the end. Please note, this webinar is brought to you as knowledge sharing initiative by Jaxonpal Medical Services, and this session is streaming on Facebook Live. The recording will remain on Jaxonpal's YouTube channel for reference and promotion. I will now request Dr. Ragini Agrawal ma'am to kindly initiate the session. Ma'am.
Thank you, Vipin, for your kind introduction and introducing everyone. It is my proud privilege today to be here with the Gorakhpur, Mau and Azamgarh Society. And my co-convener for this program is today my friend, Dr. Amrita Sarkari Jaipuriar. And today's program is totally coordinated by Dr. Amrita for all these societies. And I'm thankful to President and Secretary of Gorakhpur OBGYN Society for all coordination and the ICOG points, and Mau and Azamgarh Society and to join hand and to bring this topic of the puberty issues, which is very, very important. And we should all know for this, because many a time these girls are delivered by us, and when they, those mothers come with these girls to us, it's our duty to analyze whether we are able to do this justice with their problem, or those girls will be referred to the pediatric endocrinologist or adolescent health specialist in time. So just to do first thing, we have today with us Madam Radha Jina, who needs no introduction to this gathering. because when we are even a student from Gorakhpur Medical College, we know, we used to listen only one name, that is Dr. Radha Jina ma'am. And the when I say this thing, many of you who doesn't know her will think, ma'am looks so young, how can be she my teacher? But I don't know what lies behind this beauty of madam along with her brain. So madam, we are really, really happy that you have joined us, and you are giving your valuable time. We are sparing your valuable time with us, and please give us few word of wisdom on the puberty. Over to you, Radha Jina madam.
Thank you, Dr. Agni, for your such nice words, and it is my proud privilege to be a part of this very, very important webinar on puberty issues, which is one of the series of women's intimate health lectures. Now, I sincerely thank Dr. Ragini Agrawal for giving me this honor today. Ragini, I really appreciate your sincerity and devotion towards your work as well as your academics. Now, I think we all are seeing Ragini 2 or 3 times a week in these webinars. Hats off to you, Ragini.
Almost every day, ma'am. Almost
every day or minimum 2 to 3 days in a week. Now, we all highly value your work, experience, knowledge, and service you are rendering as far as the cosmetic gynecology is concerned. Now, we all know that puberty is a transition phase between childhood to adulthood. And puberty is the process of physical changes through which a child body matures into an adult which is capable of sex and reproduction. Now, during this phase, the hypothalamus, pituitary, and gonadal hormones, they are secreted more in amount. So they bring about secondary sexual characters in a child, whether he is a girl or he is a boy. Now today, Dr. Chandan Kachru, a very dynamic speaker, I have heard her in so many webinars, is going to speak on this important topic of normal puberty, and which will be followed by discussion on medical issues in puberty by esteemed panelists. So my sincere well wishes to the speaker as well as these panelists. So thank you very much for giving me this chance. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, madam, for thank your kind you, words. And with your blessings, we hope we are do justice in our work for today. For many of viewers who has given their valuable time and joined us, we will able to do the justice to this work.
Okay.
And after this, we'll move on. So today's guest of honor is Dr. Swasti Singh.
I'm Dr. Swasti Singh from Azamgarh. And at present, I'm the immediate past president of IMA. I have been the past president of FOCSI from Azamgarh. And it's really a great honor for me for having been invited today by Ragini. Ragini, as she has already said, she has been my very close friend and my, in fact, roommate and the bed partner throughout. Mm. And it's really a deep honor for me. So I'm really delighted to be here with all the distinguished faculties at this Women's Intimate Health Lecture Series, which is organized by our dynamic and energetic National Vice President, dear Ragini, and together with the enthusiastic Gorakhpur OBS Gyne Society, hosted by Jackson Powell. So I extend my heartfelt gratitude to Ragini and the organizers for making me a part of this important series. And today's topic is also very, very important regarding puberty, because it is not only a physiological transition in a child's life. It comes with various other changes, which can worry the parents and the doctor as well. The most important point is that puberty may also be accompanied by social, emotional, and mental problems amongst the children. And their well-being has been impacted a lot by COVID-19 as well, pandemic as well. So recognizing and dealing with it is the need of the hour. And I'm sure we are going to have a great panel, and we are going to have a very nice lecture on normal puberty as well as abnormal, precocious, and delayed puberty and other medical problems involved with puberty. And with these words, I wish you all safety in these trying times, and I request the moderators to continue with the webinar. Thank you.
Second guest of honor is Dr. Kusum Verma. She's from Mau. She's the director of Ashish Nursing Home at Mau and founder of Mau Obs and Gynae Society. She is also the founder of Mau Nursing Home Association. And she has been a chairperson at AICOG Kolkata and AICOG Varanasi. And she is the past vice president of UPNHA, past president of IMA Mau, and past president of Inner Wheel Club Mau. So she is very, very dynamic. I hope she's here. Dr. Kusum, quickly move on to the first academic session. And to chair this session, I'll call upon very, very dynamic chairpersons, Dr. Madhubala Sharma. She's the president for Obs and Gynae Society, Gorakhpur. I call her an emblem of dynamism because she's very active in extracurricular activity. And also when there is serious hard work, she's very stiff in that also. And another chairperson also needs no introduction. She's Dr. Seema Pandey from Azamgarh, and she is very famous foxin and is an infertility specialist and has made a place in the Endocrinology Society. So over to both the chairpersons, Dr. Madhubala and Dr. Seema Pandey. Our speaker is none other than Dr. Chandan Kachru, and we already heard about her from Madam Gina, and now over to chairpersons.
Good evening, everybody, and I'd really like to thank all of you for being here for this webinar in association with GOGS, though everything is frankly organized by Dr. Agni Arwal, and she was the one who initiated all into this. But I know you're all waiting for the topic for today, and for that, I would like to introduce our speaker, Dr. Hello?
Yeah. Yes.
Dr. Chandan Kachru. At present, she is the consultant of OBGYN and adolescent health specialist of West W. Pratiksha Hospital in Gurgaon. Her present affiliations are FOXI, GOGS, and I was confused because we are also GOGS. This is Gurgaon Obstetric Gynecological Society, Haryana OBGYN, AHA, IAAH, ISOPAB, HAGE, IAGE, and IMLEA. Her major achievements are master training, Helping Baby Survive Program, the Master Trainer of Sath Sath Program of Perigentology, LAP, Master Trainer EMTCT, POPSI. She has done a Master Course in Adolescent Health from Imperial College London, European Training in Adolescent Health from Lausanne University, Switzerland, and WHO presented worthy and phenomenal presentation on life skill education in adolescent health at the 2019 World, conducted a workshop on male adolescent health with Dr. Bernhard Steyer at European Congress of Adolescent Health in 2018. She's been around with her achievements. Her awards have been the Lukman Award for contribution in adolescent health. She has had various national and international publications in journals there. She has a chapter on adolescent counseling in the textbook of perinatology counseling in JB publication. Though it may not seem to be a very important topic, but when you deal these just puberty attaining girls, and especially if all of us have generally had children passing through their phase, we know what a trying time it is physically, socially, emotionally. And I think she's the best person to go to. And over to you, Dr. Chandan, for your talk now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, chairpersons, and a special thanks to Dr. Radha Gina ma'am, who has introduced me very well, and especially to Dr. Agni Agarwal. Whatever I am, I'm because of her. She's my mentor and my guide. Thank you, ma'am. Talking about normal physiology of puberty, and to understand the abnormal, we have to know about the normal physiology. So it comes from a Latin word, pubertum. It means age of maturity, and it is a complex developmental process which results in sexual maturation. So puberty starts from late childhood period to the early half of adolescence, and adolescence is divided into three phases: early 10 to 13 years, mid 13 to 16 years, late 16 to 19 years, and puberty involves early and mid adolescence. Now, by definition, puberty is defined as a period of transition from childhood to adulthood that encompasses physiologic, somatic, and constitutional changes associated with further development of the internal and external genitalia and sexual secondary sexual characteristics. Now, appearance of secondary sexual characters, cognition, function development are the major pitfalls of this. And for psychological development, it needs a separate discussion. Here, we will be talking more of the physical part. And genetics and ethnicity play a very important role. Further, we will be discussing it in detail. Now, the characteristics of puberty are maturation of the hypothalamic pituitary gonadal axis and its functional integrity with adrenal cortex, appearance of secondary sexual characteristics, and acceleration of growth and capacity to have fertility. Now, factors which affect puberty are prevalence of malnutrition or obesity, chronic diseases, socio-economical condition, environmental factors like pollution, etc., and genetics. Age of onset very variable. Boys, it starts from 9 to 14 years, or in girls, 8 to 13 years. Now, what is this hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis which Dr. Radha Jina was discussing? Now, we know about it and the role played by the hypothalamus and the pituitary by releasing the hormones and their action on the various target organs. Now, GnRH neurons are the primary role player in the initiation of puberty. The GnRH neurons develop in the olfactory placode and then migrate to the area of the hypothalamus during the gestational period. Now, GnRH acts as a self-primer on the gonadotropin cells by inducing cell surface receptors specific for GnRH and necessary for its action. Prior to puberty, hormonal feedback and central neurosuppression of GnRH release suppresses the onset of puberty. But by puberty, when it begins with the pulsatile secretion of GnRH from these neurons and other neurotransmitters which help in which are linked to this is GABA and NMDA as well. Now, the gene KIS1 and neurokinin B have recently been shown to be involved in the regulation of GnRH release. During puberty, the negative feedback mechanism is less sensitive, allowing for higher levels of FSH and LH to circulate within the body. FSH increases the estrogen production by the ovaries in girls and in boys, triggers testicular growth and supports maturing spermatozoa. LH initiates ovulation and creates the corpus luteum in females, and males acts on lytic cells in the testes to increase testosterone production. Now, this is the diagrammatic representation of what this HPO axis does. In females, hypothalamus pituitary gonadal axis, the FSH hormones and the LH hormone is produced and further acts on ovaries and produces estrogen and progesterone, which leads to the reproduction. In the adrenal axis, it is the ACTH hormone which acts on the adrenal cortex, produces the cortisol with its metabolic effect. We know about this, and the stress also plays a very important role. Now, stages of pubertal development are adenarche, growth spurt, thalarche, which is the breast development, pubarche, which is the development of pubic and axillary hair, menarche, and we will be dealing with it one by one. Now, adenarche occurs progressively in late childhood from age 6 to 7 years to mid-adolescence. The clinical signs of adrenal androgen precedes the linear growth spurt by 2 years. It is expressed by DHA and DHEAS. Increase in size and differentiation of inner zones, zonal reticularis of adrenal cortex happens, and the growth of pubic and axillary hair is due to these adrenal androgens. Now, this is the diagrammatic representation of adenarche, and we can see the DHS and cortisol, how they increase in during the puberty. Now, the second is the growth spurt. Pubertal growth accounts for about 20% of final adult weight, adult height. Growth during pubertal peak hyperplasia, normal female 9 centimeters per year, and normal male 10.3 centimeters per year. Then males usually are taller than the females by 12 to 14 centimeters because of 2-year delay in bone closure, and they also have 2 centimeters more of growth during the growth spurt. Pubertal weight gain accounts for about 50% of an individual adult body weight. Now, in growth in girls, which occurs in 2 years earlier than boys, in 1 year, rate doubles. Average girl reaches this growth peak after 2 years of breastfeeding and 1 year prior to menarche. The growth is due to estrogens and growth hormone, insulin-like growth factor, and influenced by growth in utero as well. Factors which affect the pubertal growth are estrogens, which have a direct action on epiphyseal growth plates and increase the growth hormone secretion. Androgens, like I told you before only, thyroid, then human growth hormone, which increases the insulin resistance. Insulin and insulin-like growth factors, along with their associated binding protein, working in concert with the genetic and nutrition environments. Nutrition, we know that malnutrition causes the stunted growth. Acute exercise leads to low levels of estradiol and IGF levels, and this also explains why the athletes have problems with their menstrual cycles during the pubertal age and in adolescence. Leptin is very important these days, and a lot of research is going on this protein, and this regulates the appetite and metabolism through the hypothalamus and is very much genetically related. Sexual maturity rating of Tanner staging. What is Tanner staging? This is the physical measurements of development based on external primary or secondary sex characteristics, such as the size of breast, genitals, testicular volume, and development of pubic hair. Now, breast, we know that the Tanner stage is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, depending upon how the breast tissue increases. No glandular tissue, then 2 breast bud forms, then first mound, then increased breast size, and adult size is the Tanner 5. In the diagrammatically, it is represented as this one. And very important for the pubertal to see whether it is delayed or whatever. Now, pubic hair, the Tanner stages also is diagrammatically, you can see in the picture. This is what happens in the boys, the pubarchy. Now we come to the menarche. In general, menarche occurs 24 months after thalarche. Approximately 18 months is required between initial onset of menarche and regular ovulatory cycles. Of all menstrual cycles in normal adolescents, 12 to 14 year old, 90% are anovulatory. Now, this is a very nice tabulated form of seeing the ovarian volume. With increase in the age during the adolescence, we'll see that the ovarian volume also increases. And there is a very important to notice that microcysts and macrocysts are formed, which usually we consider normal during the 2 years of puberty. Now, you see that there seems to be a continuous growth of the ovaries throughout childhood, and in a normal patient population assessed in a retrospective study, the increase was about from 6% to age of 6 to 26 at the age of 14 years. Now, ovulation, first ovulation occurs 6 to 9 months after menarche. Plasma progesterone remains at low levels, even in second sexual characters have appeared. Plasma testosterone rises, but not as seen in males. Prepubertal uterus is teardrop shaped, but then it becomes pear shaped. The uterine body increases in length and thickness. Mons pubis and labia majora and minora increase in size. Vaginal epithelium is stratified squamous and contains glycogen. pH is acidic. Now, puberty is one event in a dynamic process that begins in utero, and genetics plays a very important role in it. The evidence also says that LIN28B, the gene most strongly associated with variation in pubertal timing, across multiple genome-wide association studies, which are very much going on still, affected timing of both thalarche and menarche. The latest study associated lysine-specific demethylase genes with age at menarche, raising the possibility that epigenetic changes, including methylation, may also influence the pubertal timing. Findings that global DNA methylation in adult women and epigenetic age in adolescent girls may be associated with age at menarche provide further support of this concept. There's another gene, which is IGSF10, was the first gene to be associated with self-limiting delayed puberty. The gene KIS1, KIS-IR, TACC3 and TACCR3 encode signaling molecules and receptor that promotes GnRH secretion. The future, the last decade has seen significant progress in the identification of genes that affect pubertal timing, with the discovery of hundreds of common genetic variants that affect normal puberty, pubertal timing, and the first single gene causes of precocious and delayed puberty. This knowledge is going to help us treat these conditions in a better way. Now, from the normal to the abnormal, over to you, chairpersons. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Chandan, for such a simple and such a clear talk. I mean, like, people who must have thought ki puberty is acid, they must have been so like, wow, this was a very wonderful deliberation. And I think everyone is very crystal clear about the normal puberty. And over to you now, Dr. Amrita, for the proceedings.
Thank you, dear Chairperson, Dr. Madhubala ji. And I can't see Seema, but thank you, Seema, if you're there. If you're not also there, then also thanks a lot. And Madam Chandan, your talk was so nice. You're a brilliant orator. I heard you for the first time, but it was too good. Now we quickly move to our panel discussion. Will be moderated by Dr. Ragini Agarwal and myself. And Dr. Ragini Agarwal has already been introduced. And she is the founder of all everything in Haryana and Gurgaon related to Gyne. And our brilliant and learned panelists are Dr. Ashima, Dr. Ekika, Dr. Poonam Dixit, Dr. Reena Shivastha, Dr. Sampat Kumari, Dr. Upma Jaiswal, and Dr. Usha Singh. Over to you, Ragini ma'am.
Thank you, Amrita. So today we are going to discuss one topic which is very important because these pubertal girls come to us and many times we are in dilemma how to talk to them. Because we all more and more associated with the adult gynecology, and then nowadays even menopause and beyond menopause is also being discussed. The most less discussed area is the puberty and the adolescent problem in general practices. So as Chandan has told very clearly that it is a period of a transitional growth. Dr. Radhajina Madam has also said this thing, and it is basically the bridging the childhood years and adult. Genetic blueprint housed within the genome of the individual has long before set in motion a number of the critical processes. So basically what we are today is our genetic blueprint, which decided how we are going to behave when we come out of the uterus. Our growth is there, we become pubertal girl, being to the reproductive age group, to the menopause. Everything in our body is governed by our genome. So end result is the maturation of the multitude of endocrine axes necessary for secondary sexual character to the attainment of the immediate capacity for reproduction. Next slide, please. Intrinsic to this reproductive maturation is yet another important process of puberty, a secondary wave of skeletal growth and attainment of the adult time. These things are very important when a pubertal girl comes to with any problem to us. Height is one of the major factors for thinking how much this puberty is going, whether it is delayed, whether it is a precocious puberty, how it is affecting the growth. So abnormal puberty, whether premature or delayed, influence each of these events resulting in untimely or altered ability for spontaneous secondary sexual development, spontaneous reproduction, or abnormal growth. Next slide, please. So today what we are going to discuss, puberty disorder I will discuss, and puberty menorrhagia will be discussed by Dr. Amrita. So when we talk about the puberty disorder, there are only two things, either precocious puberty or delayed puberty. Next slide, please. So I will come directly to my esteemed panelist who are introduced by Dr. Vipin Tyagi. But whenever I call a person, I will again introduce Dr. Poonam Dixit. She's a renowned specialist from Patna Medical College. And she is very, very knowledgeable. And I know when Dr. Poonam will speak, she will speak whatever I am telling in person. She's going to give a very clear message to all of us as far as the puberty problems are concerned. So Dr. Poonam, what are the salient point when a patient comes to you, how you are going to evaluate a suspected disorder of the puberty?
Thank you, Dr. Ragini. Just now you mentioned in your introduction that there are only two issues. Either the puberty can be very early or it can be delayed. So the salient features are, first we need to assess we have to take the history. We have to know the height of the girl who has come. Then also understand the background, why parents have brought her to us. And then depending on what we find, we have to evaluate further by doing hormonal tests, ultrasound. So these are the basic investigations. And then we go from, this is the baseline from where we have to build up. So what I would like to emphasize from clinical perspective, right in the beginning, we should not order too many tests because the cost becomes too much and that becomes a limiting factor. So in nutshell, this is what I would like to say. This is the primary workout for a puberty disorder.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Poonam. So basically, whenever a patient comes to us, anything in the medicine, history is important. And next thing will come, examination. Next slide, please. And third thing, which is very important in the history, that is the family history. And when we see for the examination, as I told that height is very important. So when we see that a person with a very tall parents with a smaller height, it itself shows that patient is not getting a proper growth development. So there's been a formula to the target weight, which is very, very, when I made this slide, I first time came to know that there's a formula which you can get a height or predict a height. Mother's and father's height plus 13 centimeter for boys or minus 13 centimeter for girls divided by 2. At least that child should be having that much of the height. Next slide, please. Next slide. So the patient's sexual maturity, how you will rate, you will see the whether she's having axillary or facial hair. What is the color of the vagina? Acromegaly or not, to exclude the CH, and other thyroid, abdomen, neurological system, and any dysmorphic features. That is also important to see at this point, because many a time it is comes as a syndrome, Turner or McQueen-Albright syndrome. Dr. Ashima, are you there? Dr. Ashima, is she joined?
Yes, ma'am, I'm there.
Okay, so Dr. Ashima is a pediatric.
Yes, ma'am, she joined.
Yeah. So Dr. Ashima, in between, please, we need your inputs also. Next slide, please.
Sure,
so I'm directly coming to the case. Next slide, Deepika. So it is a 5-year-old girl, which has come in your OPD, and she has a developed abdominal mass, 2 months duration. This is a bilateral breast enlargement, 1.5 months. She was well till about 2 months prior to presentation. She developed abdominal mass, which was slowly enlarging. Breast was also noticed to be progressively enlarging. And she was full term delivery, no problem in the neonatal or postnatal period. She has 2 siblings, both are absolutely normal. And her other developmental milestone till now is absolutely normal. Next slide, please. On examination, her mother is 30 years, father is 35 years. It is non-consanguineous marriage, and her height is 90th percentile of WHO growth, and her weight is 20 kg, 75th percentile on WHO growth chart. There is no skin lesion, no palpable lymph, no goiter. Next slide, please. Next slide. So pubic hair stays 2, breast was bilaterally enlarged. As Dr. Chandan has shows that the tenor stage, it was tenor stage 4, pulse is 90, blood pressure is normal. And although no internal vaginal examination was done, but external examination, there's no active bleeding, no spotting, no vaginal discharge, no digital examination was done in this patient. So her biochemistry, if you see, she's anemic, 7.6 gram. Her hormonal assessment, serum 17B estradiol is 242 picomole. And if you see the range, it is little on the periovulatory side. FSH is 0.98 and LH is 0.67. Abdominal ultrasound shows a large solid cystic suprapubic mass, and this mass is consistent with the right ovary and morphology of the ovarian masses, granulosa cell tumor. Now, coming to Dr. Upma, after seeing this patient and with this diagnosis, what type of the puberty disorder you are going to diagnose and label this patient as? Dr. Upma.
Good evening, ma'am. Since this patient is a five-year-old girl, she's a clear-cut case of precocious puberty. And also she's showing she's a case of isosexual precocious puberty because the genotypic, the breasts which are enlarged is typically with the phenotypic appearance. So she's isosexual. And also on examination, it is seen that her estradiol level is high. So that suggests estrogen origin and that tumor is already present in the abdomen of granulosa cell tumor on histology. So she's a case of isosexual peripheral precocious puberty with secondary to granulosa cell tumor of right ovary.
How you will define the precocious puberty? Dr. Ashima?
Sure, ma'am. So two things very clearly that we saw from this case. One was a development which occurred before the age. So as Dr. Chandan had just told her in her lecture, normally there's a period of normative puberty to occur in both boys and girls. The pathological cutoffs that have been defined is 8 years in girls and 9 years in boys. But please remember, a girl who begins to develop it at an earlier stage, say on the earliest side of the curve, that is just when she is about to, when she just turned 8, even that child should be kept under monitoring because that she might be on an earlier side. So I think there are definitions on the next slide, ma'am.
Next slide.
So precocious puberty is diagnosed when any of the secondary sexual characteristics are identified in girls younger than 8 years and in boys it is less than 9 years. Before I just read the next point, what I want also to emphasize that you also, all of us as clinicians have to be very carefully looking at the pattern of what sexual characteristics have developed. Generally, if the entire axis is involved, it would simulate the condition of a normal centrally stimulated puberty. So thilarche would be the first sign in those conditions. And data does suggest that there is a recent trend in which children are maturing earlier. So most of the young girls have now started developing thilarche at an earlier age, before 10 years of age. And even menarche has started. Similar data from Indian subcontinent is also available. If there is a centrally stimulated isosexual puberty in boys, we have to be more and more wary of them because most of these would have some underlying pathology rather than just being a earlier maturing phenomena. So all pubertal boys younger than 9 years should also be evaluated.
Okay, Dr. Next slide, Ashima. Ma'am. So, Dr. Sampath, can you tell us,
Dr. Deepika,
what are the types of the precocious puberty?
Yes, Ragini, good evening. First of all, I thank you for giving me an
opportunity. Dr. Sampath is a president, vice president elect from the South Zone for FOXI, and she's a renowned professor and a specialist on the adolescent health. Over to Dr. Sampath.
Thank you, Ragini, for the line. See, the precocious puberty, we divide into two classes. Central precocious, that previous Prakar was telling, peripheral. Central is from the GnRH dependent. That is premature secretion of the gonadotropin from the brain is called the central precocious puberty. Peripheral is, it is not the secretion from the brain, but the estrogen and androgen production from other parts of the body. So it is central and precocious. To make it easier, as the previous speaker told, we divide it into isosexual and contrasexual precocious puberty. Isosexual, again, it is divided into complete and incomplete. Complete is with the GnRH dependent. And incomplete is independent. What are all the causes? It is mainly with the brain, the lesions such as hematoma, craniopharyngioma, and the patient already had the treatment for CH, congenital adrenal hyperplasia, primary hypothyroidism. Again, idiopathic and genetic. These are all the complete. Then in precocious puberty of incomplete is, that is with the individual, that is isolated precocious thilarche, then the menarche, and the estrogen secreting tumors of the ovary and adrenal. some ovarian cyst and Albright syndrome and iatrogenic. These are all it comes under. Again, the contrasexual puberty means it is androgen secreting ovarian or adrenal tumors and isolated precocious adrenalarchy, CAH, congenital adrenal hyperplasia and iatrogenic. So we have to divide it into central and peripheral, JNRH dependent and independent. As the previous speaker told, it could be under incomplete isosexual precocious puberty, the case must be.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Sampath. Next slide, please, Deepika. So Dr. Ashima, now we'll come back to you again. And please elaborate this CPP and peripheral PPP, as told by Dr. Sampath Kumari, just elaborate in a very simple way how we are going to differentiate between these two and what actually they are and how they are going to affect our kids. Next slide, please, Deepika.
Sure, ma'am. Thank you. So right from the first sensitization of normal puberty, I again reiterate what I just mentioned a few minutes back. Central precocious puberty, what Dr. Sampath also just said, is when the hypothalamic pituitary axis gets triggered. It could be because of any reason, right? So that is central precocious puberty. It is gonadotropin dependent. And this is a condition which is more commonly seen in girls, more commonly being idiopathic in girls. So in this, because it is the centrally acting mechanism, it was the phenomena would simulate that of a normal puberty. So the progression of puberty and the stages in which they appear would simulate that of a normal puberty. So thilarche will appear first, followed by pubarche, menarche, and somewhere the high spot would also occur in the second stage of maturation. So increasing growth velocity. So I will just recollect what we discussed in the case of the five-year-old girl. If you remember, even she had an increased growth velocity, even though it was a peripheral cause, but she also had some increased growth velocity. And that is one of the markers that we get that, yes, definitely the axis has got disturbed. So in girls, central precocious puberty is more often an idiopathic phenomena. However, pathology can also affect girls, be it trauma, neoplasm, radiation, or any other genetic conditions. And there is also an increasing role now recognized of neurotransmitters like KIS1 and neurokinins, etc., which have been implicated in why there are pubertal disturbances now increasingly being recognized in children. Amongst the pathological causes like trauma, neoplasm, or other things that can affect the hypothalamic pituitary area, they are generally more commonly seen in boys. So a boy who comes with a central precocious puberty is more likely to be having an underlying pathological cause. Next slide, ma'am.
Yeah.
And if we look at peripheral precocious puberty, this is where there is an hormonal influence outside the HPG axis, but sufficient to cause a premature occurrence of secondary sexual characters. So because there is an exogenous cause, it might not simulate the normal pattern of pubertal maturation, point number one. And sometimes they might have arrested periods of growth. So depending on what the hormonal source is, it could be more of an estrogen-related manifestation or they could be more of androgen-related manifestations. So for example, children might just present with hyperandrogenemic features, most common of which is congenital adrenal hyperplasia, the simple virilizing type. They could also be an androgen secreting tumor. And in these settings, generally the estradiol levels and the other hormonal levels would be high, but the central axis would remain suppressed. And this is how we'll be talking that when we talk about the diagnosis, how that helps us in differentiating these two conditions. What has also been mentioned as a very, very common cause of peripheral precocious puberty is hypothyroidism. So how hypothyroidism? So please understand, this is the state where our TSH is usually elevated, and it is the molecular mimicry between the TSH and LHFSH which triggers an abnormal pubertal onset in these children. So the clue of catching such children is, in these children, despite them having developed some secondary sexual characters like thilarche, their height would be actually stunted. They are hypothyroid. And they might have those characteristic changes of dry skin, etc. So these are young, short girls who, however, have developed premature thilarche. So the initial clues being good history examination, and what we will also talk in later would be the role of bone age. In these children, the bone age would be delayed. Otherwise, in any child who has precocious development of puberty, in all such children, your sexual maturation, your pubertal maturation and growth and your skeletal maturation would be in sync. Unlike a child who has hypothyroidism. So that is one of the very important clues which gives us a diagnosis. And amongst girls, looking at causes of peripheral precocious puberty, multiple cafe olle spots and fibrous dysplasias gives us a concerning evidence for an underlying diagnosis of macular albright, which is again a commonly seen condition even in Indian settings. So the initial workup in all such patients also includes measurement of FSH, LH, and the hormones being testosterone or estradiol in boys, thyroid function testing must, and bone age radiography, the importance of which I have just emphasized. Next slide, ma'am. So in cases of those who have an isolated condition in the peripheral precocious puberty, say be it just an adrenarche or a pubarche, in those children, measurement of other hormones for identifying the source of generation of these ectopic hormones like DHEAS and 17-OHP is indicated. And what has been highlighted here very importantly is that an LH level of more than 0.3 when measured in measured with the Eclia assay is sensitive enough to indicate for central precocious puberty. However, I reiterate, an isolated measurement of hormone should not be taken without putting the puzzle pieces of clinical examination together. So please do not jump up to diagnosis just on one single measurement of a hormone, because we know that measurement of these hormones is not easy. It needs validation. And again, let's not be chasing a hormone level, leaving besides your clinical sense. So in patients who have lower or higher values on clinical or in any clinical suspicion, we do mandatorily do a GnRH stimulation test, which we will be talking about in the next few minutes. And again, in diagnostic uncertainties, or probably to just complete your diagnosis, the workup for diagnosis of all patients who come with precocious puberty, pelvic ultrasonography for ovarian volumes and uterine sizes is also important to be documented. And you might also be able to identify any abnormal masses, which could be actually the cause of the peripheral precocious puberty in some cases. Next slide, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Ashima.
Yes, ma'am.
So to summarize whatever Dr. Ashima and the previous speakers have spoken, it's a very busy slide of the algorithm. If a patient comes to you, the cut mark is 8 years of the age for us, because we see mainly girls. The first thing is always remember only history and examination for everyone. Then only we have to jump for the test, basically LH, FSH, estradiol. Thyroid function is very, very important. 17-OHP to rule out the CH, or sometimes partial CH is also very important, and bone age radiography. Either there's an isolated examination finding, or there's a hypothalamic pituitary gonadal axis activation. So here, when there's an isolated, we have to rule out sometime, maybe the girl is obese, there's a fatty breast tissue. It has nothing to do with the any type of abnormality. It is just a lipomastia, but sometime it is a premature thalarche. There might be a prepubertal vaginal bleeding. And when there's a HPA axis, you will get an atypical pubertal progression or early but otherwise typical pubertal growth. And accordingly, you have to go and stepwise step, you have to go and diagnose. So doing this particular webinar is my aim to come to my fellow gynecologists. This is a time when we have to think of a multidimensional, multidisciplinary approach. Yes, a girl is coming to us, we have evaluated, and it is a time, maybe I am not the person who is going to treat her completely, better to refer her to a pediatric endocrinologist or an endocrinologist in time, so the things can be taken care of. Next slide, please. Next slide, Deepika. Deepika, next slide. I think Ashima, you are going to take this case also. How do we manage these cases? Because I think Reena is not...
Thank you, ma'am. No issues, ma'am. I'll do that. So again, management again depends on the underlying cause. So please remember, first getting the diagnosis right, which Dr. Ragini just emphasized. So in cases of central precocious puberty, please remember the cause is somewhere in the hypothalamus pituitary axis. And again, I'll restrict my talk to, in 90% of these cases, these are idiopathic. So you need not do any intervention for the lesion, or you might not be able to find any lesion up in the hypothalamic pituitary area. However, because this is a pathological condition, and you would want to stop these changes, treatment with GnRH analogs is indicated in. So before you, so obviously after you've established the diagnosis, you've done the hormonal test and the GnRH stimulation test, brain imaging, especially for the pituitary hypothalamic fossa, specifically to be written on the form, is a must before you label it as idiopathic central precocious puberty. And why we want to treat them early? Not just because they have pubertal concerns and they might end up having menarche early, but they have these, please remember, in precocious puberty, the entire mechanism has got accelerated. So a child who was to mature and develop menarche at say 10 years or 11 years has now developed it at probably 6 years or 7 years. So her, and with a bone age maturation. So these children, even though they appear to be taller at presentation, they are going to end up really short because they've already fast-tracked their growth velocity in this period. So there are many, many concerns apart from just halting the pubertal maturation, is also height. And the most important of all these children are highly susceptible to sexual abuse. So you would also want to take care of these children and their, and educate the parents that kindly take care of this child. She is not mentally prepared to handle all these changes and like develop those normal relations with her peers. So that is one thing, again, I would like to emphasize to this August audience, that these are also concerns why we would want to diagnose and treat them early. Next slide, ma'am.
Next slide.
So treatment remains GnRH analogs, but before you label that, because that treatment is going to continue for some few years, we would want to do a GnRH stimulation test. So the test is a simple outpatient-based test where we inject subcutaneously the GnRH analog. Usually we use triptoline single dose 100 micrograms, and then we measure the LH levels at baseline and then at 2 hours and 4 hours. So a peak LH level of more than 3 to 5, or we generally take it as more than 5, is suggestive of a central precocious puberty. And levels which do not get stimulated are probably, we know that this is not a central precocious puberty, but probably the cause is somewhere else, which we need to investigate. Next slide, ma'am. So we do measure the basal LH, and as ma'am had just said, that the cutoff of 0.3 is highly sensitive for detection of central precocious puberty. But again, please remember, these are assay dependent estimations. So in many books, you would find a cutoff of 0.6 also mentioned, which is also okay if you're measuring it by the CLIA, by the chemiluminescence. Again, even for a basal LH of say 0.35, of 0.4 or 0.5, I would still suggest please do a GnRH stimulation test to confirm that yes, this is central precocious puberty where peak LH levels are more than 5, and only then label her with that diagnosis and start treatment. And if possible, refer her early to a specialist.
Next slide, Deepika.
So apart from doing the hormonal test, growth velocity charting, bone age assessment, what we also need to complete as part of workup is ovarian imaging and thyroid testing, pelvic ultrasound to measure both uterine volume and ovarian volumes, uterine length and ovarian volumes. And estradiol levels, the reason why they are not very helpful is again because the assay is not very easy. However, we do take a cutoff of more than 20 picograms per ml. Few textbooks have also recommended a lower cutoff of say 10 to be taken. But again, measurement and variability in the hormonal assessment might not leave that as a gold standard. So in any case, if you get markedly elevated levels, then these are obviously, it is right there in front of you to label her as an abnormal precocious puberty.
Next slide.
So we come back to treatment. So again, talking of central precocious puberty in girls, knowing that most of these are idiopathic, where we will not find any underlying pathological cause like a tumor or an inflammatory condition, most of these need treatment to halt the puberty, which we do by GnRH analogs. And So these, how do these work? These work by desensitizing the puberty and decreasing the size of the release of LH and FSH hormone. Next slide, ma'am.
Next slide, Deepika.
Okay, so till when do we give or why do we give? As I just said, that use of these analogs maintains a sustained level of these hormones in the body, which in turn gets a negative feedback to suppress these hormones. And how we will be titrating the doses and how do we do that? I think there is a slide next after this, which I will, which I would want to discuss there, ma'am.
Next slide.
Okay, so next measurement. Slide. Yes, ma'am, this we've already covered. Next slide, ma'am.
Yeah, next slide. So, Dr. Poonam, would you like to take this question? What are the signs of effective treatment and how long it should be continued? Next slide, Deepika. Yeah, Dr. Poonam?
Yes, I think you have already shown the... See, whenever we get the positive result of the treatment, then we know it is working, like decrease in the breast size, cessation of periods, and diminishing size of the uterus and ovary. And they will appear, say, we have to allow reasonable length of time, say 6 months of treatment, when the signs will start diminishing. And I would like to repeat here that we would like to take help of people like Dr. Ashima when we are treating such patients, because this is a highly specialized field of treatment. It's not a very common condition, isn't it, Ashima? Maybe in your center, you would get a lot of such patients, but an average gynecologist will not see many such patients and will not have much experience. So that's a very important point to consider. And very important point, which Ashima has already highlighted, I would like to repeat. We have to prevent the sexual abuse or exploitation of these young girls.
So the thing is that we will continue treatment till the our normal age of the puberty of the patient comes. And when we stop this treatment within a 1.5 years, the patient, the girl will start having a normal periods and everything. So Dr. Ashima, again, over to you. What are the doses, preparations, mode of deliveries for these analogs? How you will treat? Because as a gynecologist, basically, we have to be aware for each and everything, because the patient has a faith on us and they will talk to this thing to us. Whether we treat this patient or not, we should be totally aware and able to talk to the patient accordingly. Next slide, please. Dr. Sure, Ashima.
Ma'am. I think we, before I talk about this, you raised a very important point and I'll be happy to tell you that. We as pediatricians are also more than happy to be working with a gynecology colleague, because at the end of the day, if both of us are on the same same page, then the patient doesn't get confused and doesn't keep hunting for doctors. So I think that is very important that we maintain something which is common and which is, there's no harm working together. So I come back to the question that you just asked, that what preparations do we use? So again, what we are talking about here is predominantly central precocious puberty. I again reiterate, because this is the commoner form of precocious puberty that we see in girls. So we use the GnRH analogs, and most of these are available in depot formulations to be given monthly or 3 monthly. So there are various formulations, the most common of which is leuprolide, and that is easily, depending on the brands available, it is, the cost ranges from anywhere between say 2000, 2500 to 3800 injection, like monthly injection also. We start with the minimal dose, which is 3.75 mg, given as a depot intramuscular injection at 4 weekly interval. However, if the child is obese, like if she is more than 30 kgs, I would want to start with a higher dose of say 7.5 milligrams. And like Dr. Poonam had just said, what would you monitor? So don't expect something miraculous to happen after the first dose or the second dose. You would have to give her a period of observation for anywhere between the first 3 to 6 months. In those 3 to 6 months, what we are seeing is, first, what we are seeing is response to the injection in the terms of side effects. So injection site reactions do occur. And remember, these are young girls who as such are so confused as to what has happened wrong in their body. So they are not very comfortable talking to you. And they have a lot of anxiety. Even the parents are a lot of anxious. And what they are actually only worried about reading on the Google is height choti reh jayegi, height choti reh jayegi. So there are concerns which are more important than just height for them to be told. So you, apart from just giving the injection and writing a prescription, we also need to talk to them and tell them that there is a therapy available and let us work together to make it work for your child. So in the initial 3 to 6 months, you are giving it a monthly injection and you are monitoring her for height for any further progression of pubertal changes. So none of the pubertal changes will disappear. But yes, as ma'am had just mentioned, menses if had started, they would cease and they're supposed to cease. If not, then this is the right time that you increase the dose, even if it is the second or the third month. There are 3 monthly depot formulations also available for the same drug. So that gives the convenience to the patient that she need not inject it every monthly. So it can be given available again in 11.25 milligram strength. And apart from Duprolide, other decapeptyl is also available. However, it is costlier than Duprolide. So I personally have never used decapeptyl in any of my patients. All of patients have been on Duprolide injections, few on monthly and few on 3 monthly doses. There is a lot of literature now which says that compared to monthly dose, even a 3 monthly dose will achieve equal suppression. So unlike earlier thought that probably a monthly pulse would be a better drug than a 3 monthly depot, there is enough literature to say yes, 3 monthly depot, the efficacy is similar to that of a monthly depot. And what we don't have in India, but is mentioned in all books, is the subcutaneous implant of histrulline, which needs a small OPD procedure, and it can be inserted with a minor, something like a CLW that is done. So we don't yet have this available in our country, but yes, this is used in the US also. Next slide, ma'am.
Thank you, Ashma. It is just like Implanon, which we have, we give the for the contraception. I think this is something like that only. So what in the literature says that the 30 experts from the Europe, there's a consensus, the efficacy of the GnRH analog in increasing adult height is undisputed in early onset of the precocious puberty. So what are the isolated pubertal changes which we are talking for so many times? Dr. Usha.
Sorry to interrupt you, ma'am. Thank you, Dr. Usha. Ma'am, before we go on to the isolated pubertal changes, I wanted to highlight one more thing. Yeah. There are many parents who would come, say, bringing their young girls, say 7 years, 7.5 years, even 8.5 years, who've started Thilarke, ki, doctor, please prescribe a GnRH analog so that further puberty does not progress and she can keep growing taller, because this is at least a concern which very frequently comes to us as pediatricians. For parents with girls, say just 8 years or 8.5 years. So, ma'am, what is there as evidence that even in girls with pathological precocious puberty, those who received treatment or were detected and started on treatment before 6 years of age and the pubertal progression was halted, in these children, when you gave them therapy, their height improved. However, in those, if you start late, say at 7 years or 7.5 years, which Dr. Usha will be talking about conditions of premature Thilarke, etc. In these children, even when you give GnRH analog, say till 12 years of age, the height potential does not improve. So what Dr. Ragini had shown in an earlier slide of calculation of the mid-parental height, each child is destined to grow to as per her genetic potential. So if the mother and father are short, she will not grow tall. And if the mother and father are tall, she's bound to grow tall. So in these children, if they developed pubertal signs earlier, so a condition called early maturing girls. So these are not pathologically precocious, but because of some trigger or some variation, they might be maturing little early than their mothers. So these children ideally should not be treated with GnRH analogs for improving height outcomes. That is one very important message that I would want to emphasize here, because this is something that parents read and get misguided by many quacks outside, and they would come to you for prescription for GnRH analogs to improve the height outcomes. So just to reemphasize that this is not to be done. Thank you.
Valid.
You may point. Dr. Usha, may please proceed. Thank you.
There are two isolated pubertal changes, premature Thilarke and premature adenarche. So premature Thilarke is an isolated glandular-based development in females less than 8 years of age. It may be genetic, dietary, physiological, and idiopathic. It should always be differentiated from lipomysia, which is isolated fatty breast tissue we can differentiate these conditions by examining the patient in supine position. In supine position, the breast become less prominent. We can easily determine the presence on or absence of glandular tissue under areolar. And the second one is premature adrenarche, which is driven by adrenal endogenous rather than activation of HPG axis. It leads to gradual progressive appearance of pubic hair, body odor, acne, without changes in linear growth velocity or enlargement of testes, penis, ovaries, or clitoris. DHEAS may be at a pubertal level, whereas estradiol, testosterone, LH, and FSH remains at pubertal level. An isolated pubertal vaginal bleeding, which is not caused by trauma, foreign body, abuse, infection, or any rare tumor, is usually benign.
So this thing, what we are initially, we have listened from the Ashima. Now Usha has explained that woman, the girl who was coming with the isolated problem, we should just watch, not jump for any test, any treatment, because this thing is not going to affect pathologically to that girl. So Dr. Upma, would you say, how do we manage the isolated pubertal changes?
Pubertal changes, which are slowly progressing puberty, it is a part of puberty process. And the patient, if she has no neurological symptoms like headache or visual blurring or diplopia or new onset of any seizures, and her growth is normal, like she is linearly growing, her growth curve is normal and she appears healthy, we need not do anything for such patients, and the patient parents should be counseled for her. But surveillance is required every 3 months or 6 months to evaluate the progress of puberty. And even the lab investigations or the bone age, like x-ray of non-dominant hand, is maybe deferred, like it can be postponed for later. Because even if we find pathological change, like bone age is advanced in such patients, but it is a normal variation, and it could be a normal benign variation and not any pathological cause of precocious puberty.
What are the effect of early puberty disorder on the mental health of the pubertal girl, which is really the most important thing? Even somehow Dr. Ashima has covered little bit, but we want from you, because you are an adolescent specialist.
Yes, most of the time what happens is these girls, these precocious puberty girls, they know that there are early development of the breast and early development of the bleeding. Everything, they feel that they are different from the other girls, and they go for a depression. And their depression, because of the depression, there is anxiety also. The depression and anxiety makes them to involve in all other bad habits, that is substance abuse, alcohol, smoking. Most of that, I have seen girls, this precocious puberty, going for use of the substance use also. Sometimes what happens to the extreme, the sexual behavior is also started earlier with this precocious puberty girls. That is because of the hormones it may be. And the last thing, since they are going to the schools, where most of them are school going, they don't have confidence. Even whatever they read, they have the less confidence. So they go for depression, anxiety, less confidence, and the substance abuse habits and sexual behavior will be earlier in this scale of girls. So the treatment and counseling is very, very important. I have seen only few cases of precocious, but still one girl, she was used to that substance abuse, whatever the bad habits. So we should be very careful in handling these girls. Always adolescents should be handled very carefully. This precocious puberty with most careful and counseling.
So the main thing is that not only this thing, there is a social pressure.
Yes.
Because they are maturing early and they don't want to be with the same age group, because they look bigger. They have a friendship with their seniors. And the second thing, what happened, their level of cognitive, social, and the emotional development is also not consistent, because physically they look bigger, but in heart they are small kids. So difficult to live in this time. Yes. So what I want to talk this thing, this is very important slide as far as we gynecologists are concerned. We always, whenever a patient comes to us, we should, for any disease, whether it is young, old, or any age group, for anything, we have to see for a window of opportunity. In this particular patients, we should look upon for the sex education, for the family, not only the girl. Unless we talk to this their mother that she should be part of this sex education, the awareness to these girls, things are not going to be happen. Next thing is the awareness of the complication. And third thing is a Pascola. So what is Pascola? That is very important to each and every gynecologist to understand, because these girls can go for the sexual molestation, violence, maybe rape. And today's law, no gynecologist can say, I am not going to treat this patient. Even if you don't treat that patient, you don't abort that girl of the 14 years old. But if you have seen that girl, it is your duty to inform the police that such and such 14, 15 year old girl came to me and she is pregnant. Otherwise, you are also penalized. So remember, not only not doing the abortion, if you have seen, your duty to inform the authority is must, and this is the Pascola which each and every person should understand. That Pascola means that any underage girl, if she's even have a consensual sex, it comes under the rape. And as a doctor, it is your duty. So coming to the next case discussion, here we have a 17.5 year old healthy girl. We will go a little quickly, Deepika. So she denies any abnormal pain, fatigue, headache, also denies excessive exercise, dieting, not taking any medication, but she has no sexually secondary breast character, no breast development, and she still not attain a menarche. Her mother and older sister achieve menarche at the age of 12 years. Next slide. Girl, weight is 45 kg, height is 153.5 centimeter, body mass index is 19, that is 20th percentile. Vital signs are normal, she has no dysmorphic feature. She is attentive, interactive, thyroid gland is normal, skin evaluation yields normal result, no abnormal hair distribution. Next slide, please. She does not have any breast development. She does not have a dark, coarse pubic hair. She has no clitoromegaly or vaginal discharge. Abdomen is soft, not distended. No mass is palpable. No other finding to note. Next slide, please. Dr. Usha, what will be your original diagnosis date?
As patient girl's age is
Dr. Usha. 70.
Yes. Hello. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah, tell me.
Yes. Okay. As the patient age is 17.5 years with no development of breast and the menarche, so she is a case of delayed puberty. In delayed puberty, where is absence of breast development by the age of 13 years of age. 13 years.
Okay. So, Dr. Ashima, how will define delayed puberty and what are the causes for the delayed puberty? Next slide, please.
So delayed puberty is, we'll restrict to girls. So absence of any sexual characteristics by 13 years of age in girls, or in boys, we take that cutoff as 14 years. Or even absence of menarche by age of 15 or 16 should be taken as delayed puberty. The causes, again, we can divide it into something which is which has a central component and something which has a peripheral component. So amongst the central, constitutional delay in growth and puberty is one of the commonest causes. and it presents an extreme of the normal spectrum. So in these cases, history of maternal age of menarche becomes very important. So if the maternal age of menarche was late, probably the index case might also have a late menarche. But in this case, the index case which has been shown, she is 17 and a half. So she cannot be left as any historical, for any historical evidences. She has to be investigated for pathological cause of delayed puberty. And in these, because there is a lack of the hormones from the axis, it is a hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism versus a peripheral cause in which there is an ovarian failure or something like that. In which case, because of lack of negative feedback, the LHFSH levels are usually high, as we see in Turner syndrome. So these cases are hypergonadotrophic, but they are hypogonad. So these can again be congenital or acquired. We need not enlist the causes. All of these are there in your books. So ma'am, I think we can let go of the theory.
Yeah. Next slide, next slide, next slide. Deepika, next slide.
Yes, ma'am. So once you know, once you've identified as a cutoff that yes, this child fits into a diagnosis of delayed puberty, next we would want to see what is the cause. So a good history for any underlying systemic causes. And mind you, in children, ancillary secondary causes like uncontrolled diabetes, underlying chronic kidney disease, even states of anorexia, malnutrition, these are commoner causes of delayed puberty than just Turner's or any other syndromic causes. So this is a busy slide, but just to make it simple, go as per a normal clinical examination. So you would want to take a good clinical history, examine for any evidence of systemic, any identifying factors of systemic causes like Turner's, do a growth velocity plotting and measurement of hormones and after the baseline investigation. So please screen for treatable causes like CKD, treatable causes like liver diseases, etc. LH and FSH will help you classify broadly whether they are hypogonadotrophic, in which LH and FSH would be suppressed, or they are hypergonadotrophic, in which those levels would be measurable or elevated. Next.
So Dr. Sampath, how you will manage this case? Next slide.
Please, you have mentioned it. Looks like a hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism only. So for this case, I think first we have to, everything has been evaluated. We can go with the estradiol combination. I have never used that, but still the transdermal estradiol patches, that is 25 microgram, it is 24 hour patch. It can be used for 4 to 6 months. If there is an improvement and if everything is normal, this can be stopped. If there is no improvement, again, she has to be evaluated and the long-term treatment has to be given. The main thing has to be continued. Okay. So the transdermal estradiol patches is the cause. So we have to treat with the trans, mainly the transdermal estradiol patches will be useful. Each patch is 25 microgram, which can be used for 24 hours. And this has to be continued for 4 to 6 months. Then we have to see whether the treatment, whether she is having the growth development and bleeding and everything. If there is no improvement after 6 months, the treatment, she has to be evaluated and the long-term treatment has to be continued. This is the treatment for hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Sampath. Next slide. So, Dr. Poonam, what we are discussing so long, what are the indications for the referral to a pediatric endocrinologist when these girls comes? Next slide, Deepika.
Okay, Ragini, before I proceed, I would like to say the transdermal patches of estrogen are not available locally. At least in Patna, they are not available. Long back, estrogel was available. Ashima, is it available? Can you answer that? Because that will be very efficient.
Not available in our country.
So we can give the natural, other preparations.
Oral.
Like, estradiol, valerate,
tablets. Dr. Sampath, ma'am.
Yes, the transdermal purchase is not available for the treatment, but I have never used that solo. Then estradiol, if at all needed, you can go with the tablets. And if at all needed injections, yeah, the low dose, the patch is not available. For completion only, yeah. I told
we have to give them
Yes.
We have to give them oral tablets because right now I have a patient and I'm endocrinologist is also seeing her along with me and she's on oral estrogen tablets. So coming to your question, Ragini. So, yeah.
So we have to involve them whenever we are in doubt. And I would think, because it is such a sensitive issue, we should involve them right from the beginning, you know. And as Ashima was saying, that we should work as a team. So the girl, you know, like as a gynecologist, I can do the preliminary diagnosis, provide her the support, and take the help of the expert as and when necessary. Because in many of the cases, the treatment is quite prolonged, say like precocious puberty or anything. So it has to be a team approach, Ragini. I think wherever available, a clinical psychologist should also be involved, because as Dr. Sampath was saying, the drug abuse and other issues.
Yeah. So Ashima, please, in very short, can you give the classification or the differences between these delayed puberty? Next slide, please, Deepika. Yes, Ashima, please answer.
Sure, ma'am. So we'll just reiterate what we just heard about hypogonadotrophic or hypergonadotrophic. But what has also been highlighted is an arrested sort of puberty, where initial thalarchy would have occurred, but the child does not grow further. In fact, these are the cases which could be an intersex or a disordered sexual differentiation cases. So cases of androgen insensitivity are actually detected when these girls come with primary amenorrhea, and when we end up doing a karyotype or plotting a good family history, we realize that even maternal aunts had primary amenorrhea. So broadly, just to give a highlight, we need not always, once we know it is a hypogonadotrophic or a hypergonadotrophic case, we should investigate for all treatable causes first, rule out all syndromic causes. So referral to pediatric endocrinologist, a girl with delayed puberty who's very tall, she needs to be investigated. You don't expect her to be growing in stature if she has delayed puberty, right? So girls with CAIS, complete androgen insensitivity, will invariably be taller. So pick up clues like these, which are abnormal. Girls who have some syndromic facial abnormalities, these are the girls who you would again want to investigate and classify as something to be done. And girls who have poor intellect, so these would be syndromic disorders like Bartter-Biedl syndrome, etc., which might not be, otherwise you might not be able to detect them. And the other condition is the Mayer-Rocky-Tansey syndrome, in which because of an absent vagina, they might again present with primary amenorrhea. And these children also keep on getting worked up for Turner syndrome like phenotype, but they might end up having a different diagnosis, completely different diagnosis.
As everyone was discussing, that similarly the factors which includes is mainly the first, the absence of the breast development and the absence of the pubic hair development and the Mullerian system, there may be absence of vagina or absence of uterus, whatever it is. Then finally, there will be the structure, the height will be reduced. There will be a shorter structure. So we have to see about the breast development, as Chandan was talking about the Turner stage, what is the stage it is present. And the pubic hair, again, the staging of what stage it is present, a Mullerian, whether uterus is present or vagina is present, ovary is present, which is absent, has to be evaluated. And the height, if it is shorter, it will go to the Turner syndrome. And if it is higher, whether whatever it is possible, absence of breast development, what we are going to do, hypergonadotrophic ovarian failure, the presence of breast development, that FSH and LH level has to be maintained. These are all the factors which has to be dealt. The breast development suggests cause of hypogonadism. It can be, as Asma told, ovarian failure or ovarian insufficiency or with HPV axis. That can be monitored with FSH level, whether FSH is increased or FSH is reduced. If FSH is increased, we will go with ovarian insufficiency. If FSH is reduced, it will be at the level of the hypopituitary. So this is the management with the breast development. Then similarly, the next.
So, significance of the absence of the pubic hair, Dr. Upma, very, very crisply.
Absence of pubic hairs after 13 years is a really significant marker of a serious abnormality, because pubic hairs requires dehydroepiandrosterone and dehydroepiandrosterone sulfate, and which it begins at 2 years of age and increases to 7 to 8 years and then continues till 13 to 15 years. So, and the origin could be for the adrenal androgens, which could be from adrenals or ovarian origin. So even if some amount of androgens are adrenal androgens are present at hypothalamic pituitary axis, adrenal axis should not be it should function well. Even in a small amount of pubic hair should always be present. And absence of pubic hair is a defect of pituitary function and hypothalamic function, or it could be gonadal dysgenesis or gonadal failure at all, because the stimulation of wherein androgen production is not happening, neither from adrenals nor from ovarian. So it could be isolated GnRH deficiency also. And the second is steroidogenic pathway. Even when the cholesterol is not converted to androgens, and we see it in 17 hydroxylase enzyme deficiency, 17-20 desmolase deficiency, or 5-alpha reductase deficiency. And these patients present with primary amenorrhea, no secondary sexual characteristics, hypertension, hypokalemia, but female phenotype is present. And the third is androgen receptor defect. These are actually hermaphrodites, either male pseudo-hermaphrodites, or because of presence of XY chromosomes in them, and it is X-linked recessive. So the phenotype is female. But in the internal genitalia is of male. Because of the Y chromosome, Müllerian inhibiting factors are present, and this causes regression of Müllerian duct structures internally. So externally, breasts are developed because testosterone is converted to estrogen peripherally. But the karyotype is XY, or it could be both also. They could be mosaic also, XX and XY. But with a blind vaginal pouch in case of androgen insensitivity syndrome. And if the patient has 46XXXY plus hydroxylase deficiency, there would be absence of pubic hair, there would be absence of breast tissue and Müllerian system also. So any patient who comes with absence past pubic hair, breast examination and local introital examination is very important to clinch the diagnosis. And even karyotyping is the final to make the exam diagnosis.
Thank you, Upma, because these things are so important. Even when we deliver a child and after a year or two, and especially at the puberty, many a time they come and they complain, especially that especially the CH patient girls, that they're reared as a boys. And many a time they come to your OPD that there's a small penis which is not growing. So these problems are very, very not so uncommon also. If it is not common, it is not uncommon. Or as a gynecologist, always these babies come to you. And at that time, this knowledge is very important. How to talk to them, how to counsel them, and how to refer them, and how to treat them if you can do. So what is the significance of the absent Müllerian system, Dr. Poonam Dikshit?
See, Müllerian agenesis, like as we are proceeding from the head to the top down, so when there is abnormality in the development, it can have various presentations, and much of it is obvious by a history can also give way what type of defect she has got. And broadly speaking, it is either complete agenesis or partial. In the partial, we find there is imperforate hymen, or there is a transverse septum somewhere at the junction of 2/3 and 1/3 of the vagina. The worst is where there is a cervical agenesis. That's very important to consider. So, and not to mention the our MRKH syndrome, which is that is the commonest part of Müllerian agenesis we see. And they all have normal karyotyping, but diagnosis is reasonably easy by making a good history and ultrasound, and if the need be, then more specialized investigations. And as just now, Upma very elaborately discussed about the AIS and the other things, which may form an overlap, and sometimes we may have a diagnostic dilemma.
Thank you, Dr. Poonam. Dr. Usha, what is the significance of the short stature with the delayed puberty?
Yes, ma'am. Short stature with delayed puberty indicates two causes. First is genetic, and the second is endocrine causes. In genetic causes, for both short stature and delayed puberty, like Turner syndrome. and endocrine causes in which growth is stopped many years earlier than the usual time of onset of puberty and delays the onset of secondary sexual development. Such causes are growth hormone deficiency, thyroid deficiency, or pituitary insufficiency. Constitutional delay of growth and puberty is the most common cause of short stature and delayed puberty.
Okay, thank you, Usha. So the next question I will answer, and I think everybody will answer. So most common cause of the chronic involution, we all know that the PCOS, and I'm not going to discuss at all the PCOS because we have so many webinars on the PCOS. I will just skip for the next 10-15 minutes to the Amrita, so she will talk in detail for this thing. And with a comment from Dr. Ashima, I'm closing. If anything else you want to tell Dr. Ashima very quickly, then we'll hand over this panel to Dr. Amrita for the next part.
So just to very briefly summarize that, yes, there could be phenotypic features which I just mentioned, like an obese child who has delayed puberty needs to be investigated. Somebody with dysmorphic facies needs to be investigated. But remember, in Turner, many would not have any of the Turner stigmata. So please investigate all for suspected syndromic causes. So Turner stigma, I will not repeat what all makes up a Turner stigmata, but just to keep a very high index of suspicion that anything which does not fit into a normal pattern of growth needs to be investigated and referred. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Ashima. Now over to you, Amrita, for next, I think we have 15 minutes left with us, 15-20 minutes, for a very, very important topic of the puberty menorrhagia. Over to you, Amrita.
Thank you, ma'am. And quickly, we'll be moving. Puberty menorrhagia, can any of the panelists define?
Yes.
Dr. Ukma?
Yes, I can.
Yeah, please, any of you.
Bleeding, which is more than 80 ml in quantity, or the duration is of more than 8 days in girl between menarche, after attaining menarche and 19 years of age. And then that is puberty menorrhagia. And it is also responsible for the 50% of gynecological visits in OPD of adolescent girls. Okay. The most common reason they visit the OPD.
Dr. Deepika, please run the slides because puberty has already been discussed. So we all know that onset of menstruation, just the previous slide, Dr. Deepika. Yeah, now we know the answer. The onset of menstruation is influenced by a number of factors we have learned: genetics, nutrition, body weight, and maturation of HPO axis and also HPA axis. And the onset of menstruation does not mean that ovulation has occurred. So majority of the early cycles are anovulatory, and the cycle length may vary. So my question to Dr. Sampath Kumari is, why adolescent girls should not be labeled PCOS in early adolescent period? Ma'am. Dr. Sampath.
Adolescent PCOS, and normally from the adult PCOS, we used to tell about the anovulation, clinical and biochemical features of hyperandrogenism, and last only UST. But as far as adolescent is concerned, as per Endocrinology Society also, for adult among the three, if two is present, we consider as PCOS. But for an adolescent, all the three should be present. Now the PCOS in adolescent is overdiagnosed. Only if the two, any, all three is present only, we can consider it as PCOS. First of all, anovulation should be present, or clinical and biochemical features of hyperandrogenism is to be present. And for adolescent, we don't see the follicles, 10 follicles, uterus, ovarian volume 10 and millimeter of 10 millimeter means transvaginal has to be done. For an adolescent, we are not doing transvaginal. We do only the transabdominal. If it is obese, again the follicular study will be missed. So normally for an adolescent, it should not be considered as PCOS. Now, most of the time the girls, rather than the girls, the parents come with the taking with the ultrasound features and come, they tell that their daughter is having PCOS. So the if it is a USD feature of PCOS, then there should be a description, good description, how many follicles and what is the size and what is the ovarian volume. So only the three factors if present and ovulation, that is 6 to 8 cycles, and hyper and clinical and biochemical features of hyperandrogenism. Latest one, last only the USD. So only we don't call the PCOS in adolescence, all PCOS as adolescent. It should be considered only in a clear-cut cases.
So we all know now the features include anovulatory menstruation, transient multifollicular ovarian morphology that may appear polycystic by ultrasound, increased androgen effects, and relative insulin resistance secondary to increased growth hormone levels. So adolescents with gynecological problems require reassurance and they should be advised lifestyle modification. We quickly move on to the case. A 13-year girl came to gynec OPD with complaints of extreme weakness and dizziness and also complained heavy prolonged bleeding during menstruation. Average build, BMI 23.5, menarche at the age of 12, cycle length 10 to 12 days, uses 6 to 8 packs per day, and the bleeding stops only after taking some medication. Cycle is 26 days. She is pale, pulse rate 10 per minute, 100 per minute, BP 90 by 60, and rest of the examinations do not show anything. So what is the diagnosis? So how will you define puberty menorrhagia and what are the normal parameters? We have already taken this, but still a repetition.
Ma'am, puberty menorrhagia is defined as excessive bleeding more than 80 ml, the quantity of the blood, and the duration is more than 8 days, between menarche and 19 days, years of age. And the excess flow can only be diagnosed by when the patient uses pads or super pads or tampons, changes, she has to change it every 2 hours. And the lab investigation suggests anemia. And there's lifestyle disturbance of the patient, like she's daily, her daily school activity is hindered. She's not able to play. She's not able to work normally and not able to go to school also because of this. So patient, these, and the, she's complaining of weakness also. So that is, she is a clear-cut case and her hemoglobin is less. And her BMI is also on the higher side. So that is a different case. But she is a case of puberty menorrhagia. In normal menstruation, around 35 ml of blood is lost. And the patient uses less than 21 pads per cycle initially. And she has to change pads not before 3 hours. This type of bleeding is generally heavy because it is anovulatory dysfunctional uterine bleeding. And during puberty, there is an increase in the frequency and pulses of pulsatile GnRH hormone, which initiates and regulates pituitary hormone, pituitary gonadotropins. In initial years, due to lack of maturity of hypothalamic pituitary axis, the LH pulse timing is immature. And these are sufficient to induce follicular development and estradiol secretion, but it is not adequate to induce full follicular maturation and ovulation. This causes unopposed estrogen growth, which leads
causes,
to...
is the next question, Upma. So what are the causes of puberty menorrhagia, Dr. Usha say?
Yes. Anovulatory cycle is the most common cause in puberty menorrhagia. And due to... HPG axis, immature HPG axis, and other than coagulopathy, endocrinal abnormalities, pelvic tumors, pregnancy, drugs like OCP or anticoagulants, trauma, infection, and malignancy.
So coagulation disorders are very important. And if any girl comes to us with the puberty menorrhagia, we should consider that. And factor 8 activation, factor 8 function is very, very important. So ma'am, Dr. Sampath Kumari, can you please tell us how are we going to approach such a case?
Yes, this case already you have told that the patient is having bleeding 10 to 12 days, once in 26 cycles. So it means that almost every month she has bleeding for 12 days and she is changing 6 pads. So we have to ask about that, whether she is taking any drugs and whether she is able to go to school and how many days she is absenting herself from the schools, and whether she is participating in any social activities or sports. Most of the time, what the girls will do with the profuse bleeding, they will not do the regular whatever work they are doing routinely. They will not take part. They will not take part in sports and the social activities. And the sexual history and contraceptions at present, we know it. As far as the puberty menorrhagia, now one thing we will say, only one point I want to tell. Once they have attained menarche, for first 2 years, as already the previous speaker told, it is only an HPO axis. After 2 years, if there is a bleeding irregularity, I mean, we have to assess the anemia, whether it is the mild or moderate or severe. And the bleeding disorder, first we have to rule out pregnancy in all, once they have a disorders presented, this has to be ruled out. Then the assessment, as I told, the paler and what is the hemoglobin and what is that PCV. And if there is no need for vaginal examination to be done in the adolescent, if they are sexually active and there is an amenorrhea history followed by bleeding, then only we are going to do the examination. Most of the time, the amenorrhea followed the obesity means it could be the PCOS. So we as previous slide we see, we have to rule about the hyperandrogenic feature. And in this connection, I want to tell only one thing. Dr. Ragini, when you posted the slide, it was mentioned as POSCO. It is another, it is by mistake, I think. I saw chart in the chat box also. It is a POXO Act, Protection of Children Against Sexual Abuse. I want to clear that.
Typo error ho jata hai, madam. Yeah.
First, sir. Thank you. It is by mistake, I think.
Yeah, okay.
Madam Poonam, can you please tell us how do we investigate such cases?
We have to do the complete blood count, which will give us the level of anemia. And bleeding disorders are like, you know, her platelet count, and if necessary, the function of the platelets, and exclude Bonneville brands if it is indicated by the history. So these are the basic investigations we have to do to arrive at a diagnosis, which will help us in the management also. And an ultrasound is necessary. We can sort of sometimes find fibroids or polyps even in adolescent girls. So an ultrasound is a very basic investigation which we must do when the girl presents with heavy periods. I personally find ultrasound very useful. What I see is these girls will take norethisterone off and on, which makes the endometrium quite thin, and they keep on bleeding for a very long time. So,
okay, ma'am. And how do we treat, how do we approach the treatment?
See, this girl has, if I remember correctly, she came with very heavy bleeding and she was pale and she had tachycardia. So the acute bleeding has to be controlled immediately. And for this, the preferred treatment is I use this contraceptive tablet, which is we give it 6 to 8 hourly for 2 to 3 days, which controls. And such high doses usually causes a lot of nausea and vomiting. And these girls are quite anxious. So I add estimetil twice daily so that she doesn't have vomiting and nausea. And she continues, the compliance is improved. And with that, we can add transaxamic acid in correct doses. And of course, we have to correct her anemia. If it is really bad, we can give her intravenous iron. And if not that bad, then we can give her oral iron and things like that. So a lot of supportive treatment we have to give. And we have to allay the anxiety of the girl and her parents at the same time.
Yes, ma'am, you have covered almost everything, but still, Dr. Ashima, can you throw some light on the non-hormonal treatment? Dr. Ashima?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
So in amongst the non-hormonal treatment, two drugs that we commonly use is, one is Texid, which is tranexamic acid. It can be decreases the flow during and doses usually 500 to 1 gram TDS. And otherwise, other NSAIDs like mefenamic acid, etc. also work. However, again, probably these drugs, more of these sometimes are required during the early phases when most of the cycles are anovulatory, and it is then when the girls usually take it more, or probably I see them more during that time. So my experience is usually with increased use during the early anovulatory cycle phase of adolescent girls.
Okay. Okay. Although, ma'am, Dr. Poonam, you have told us about the hormonal therapy. Can you please throw some light? How long can we continue this treatment for the adolescent girls?
The use of a combined contraceptive pill is a very recommended only for a very short time to correct, to control the acute phase. And because of the concerns with the height, so we should not continue for a long period. The initial acute episode, we will taper the dose and maximum we can give her for a month. Other hormone, which is norethisterone, that also can be given only for a short time because it there is report of virilization with the prolonged uses. So the hormone treatment is not the first line of treatment for puberty menorrhagia unless it is really bad and it is acute. So as our colleague has said, that transaxamic acid, mefenamic acid, these are the preferred lines of treatment rather than a hormonal treatment. The medroxyprogesterone, which is often recommended, but I personally think that it is not a very, it is not very good in controlling acute bleeding, but can be given for a good cycle control for a short duration of time. Depot preparations, I will not recommend, and I do not use it.
Thank you, ma'am. Madam Sampath Kumari, can you please tell us how do we assess the severity of bleeding and how do we tackle each respectively? Mild, moderate, and severe. How do we assess? Ma'am, please unmute yourself. Dr. Sampath Kumari.
Yes. So once the patient, most of the time the girls never come. One, we have received cases with a hemoglobin even of 4 gram. So depending on the hemoglobin level and the patient, whether the tiredness and the weakness, we have to assess. If they are having only mild bleeding and they have only tiredness and the hemoglobin is normal and they have bleeding only for 5 to 6 days, means we can, as everybody told, we can go with NSAIDs. And if the bleeding is not stopped with NSAIDs and the patient is, the girl is feeling very uncomfortable and tiredness, means for the moderate cases, I never go with the combination. We can go with the progesterone, that is the norethisterone or metroxyprogesterone acetate. Even for the severe bleeding, we have to stop the metroxyprogesterone or norethisterone TDS and stop the bleeding. And then you can continue the cycle with the progesterone for 6 months. It can be 21-day cycle or it can be from the 14th day during the ovulation, 14-day cycle. With the progesterone, if there is a spotting or in-between bleeding is present, then you can go with the low-dose estrogen of 30 microgram estradiol and progesterone combination for 5 to 6 months. This will be effective. In spite of that, the patient is having profuse bleeding and her hemoglobin is 3 and patient is tired and weakness, means the patient has to be hospitalized. Hospitalized means first we have to start the IV line, not the profuse fluids. IV line has to be started. Then the progesterone hormones has to be started and the bleeding has to be stopped and the blood transfusion. If the hemoglobin is less than 4 gram or 5 gram, blood transfusion should be given. And the hormones has to be continued for 21 days. And then, as I told earlier, it can be progesterone for 6 months or if spotting present, OC pills. The comment of Mirena in adolescent, if the girl is sexually active, nowadays, if there is no harm in asking them, we have to ask them. Now the 19-year-old girl comes with the menorrhagia and she is sexually active, means we can use Mirena also. Now the Mirena is useful to control the bleeding, to regularize the bleeding, to use in endometriosis, that can be used in adenomyosis. So I have used Mirena for one of the adolescent girl, 19 years, unmarried. So depending on we should ask, as already Dr. Ragini told, the HEDAS assessment, we have to ask them about what is that education, what is the sexual act, we have to put the leading question, and then you can use Mirena for adolescent also.
Okay, ma'am. So, next slide, please. Dr. Deepika.
I think we did this acute episode, no? Control of.
Okay. Yes, ma'am, you did that. And what are the indications of hospitalization have also been discussed.
Yes.
But still, just to revise, consider admission for hemodynamically unstable patients with low hemoglobin concentration, and consider transfer when advised regarding escalation of care beyond the local center, and consider discharge when the patient can be discharged and is stable. So the key points are
one point. When you want to discharge her, you have to continue the hormonal therapy.
Yes.
Now the girl will come and admit at 4 grams and we would have given blood transfusion and everything. If the progesterone is given and it is stopped abruptly, they will again start bleeding. So clear cut instruction should be given. That taper the dose, and the next month, if needed, progesterone or Rosiprol should be given. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. So the most common cause of the key points are that the most common cause of heavy menstrual bleeding in adolescents is anovulatory cycles. Mild bleeding with a normal hemoglobin can be managed with reassurance, non-hormonal treatment and observation. Pregnancy-related bleeding and bleeding disorders are important differentials to consider, and hormonal therapy aims to stabilize the endometrium. Next slide. So thank you all. Ragini ma'am, do we have time for the menstrual hygiene?
Yes, just tell the point for the window of opportunity, please.
Dr. Ragini, fantastic topic and fantastic discussion.
Carry on your window of opportunity.
Yes, ma'am. Amerika? Yes, ma'am. Deepika ji, stop sharing your slide.
Sharing her slide, I will just give one message to everyone who is hearing that Foxy has come with a wonderful medical indemnity policy, the very low premium, and you will get all support from the medical legal expert for your case and everything. Please try to switch to your medical indemnity to Foxy Run medical indemnity policy.
Thank you, Dr. Sampath. That the primary amenorrhea, such a topic, you made it very interesting. Very, very thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for your contribution. Are my slides seen?
Yes, seen.
Okay, so how do we define menstrual hygiene management? Menstrual hygiene management, or MHM, is defined as women and adolescent girls using a clean menstrual management material to absorb or collect blood that can be changed in privacy as often as necessary for the duration of menstruation period, using soap and water for washing the body as required, and having access to facilities to dispose of used menstrual management materials. This has come up because in Nepal, when there was earthquake, women had a lot of problem in handling the situation. And so for this, the menstrual hygiene management concept has come up. So women and girls in low income settings have low awareness on hygiene practices and lack appropriate materials for menstrual hygiene management practices. Poor hygienic practices and cultural restrictions during menstruation are associated with negative clinical and psychological outcome, including genital tract infections, urinary infections, anemia, school absenteeism, and social isolation. Menstrual hygiene should be a base productive health right. Sanitary napkin should be changed every 4 hours. If cloth is used, it should be clean and dry. Even if it is reused, it should be washed and dried properly. If damp, high chances of infection are there, as bacteria and yeast can grow easily. Normal blood loss per menstruation is around 40 to 65 ml, and duration is 3 to 5 days. And we have already discussed in menorrhagia what is abnormal. So since I have so many experts on menorrhagia, I just have a case, and it is a real case which I am handling. She is Miss K, 16 years, height is 155 centimeters, weight 77.4 kgs, age of menarche 14 years, and she presented with excessive bleeding PV for about a month. So this case I am handling for past 7 months, Her hemogram then in May was quite poor. Now she has improved. Her ultrasound showed thick endometrium. She has improved now, but still she is having irregular spotting, and she is on overall G, that is ethinyl estradiol and a progesterone combination, but she is still continuing to spot. Her TSH was slightly high. I gave her a thyroxin in low dose, 25 microgram, and she is okay with that, but she is still spotting. Can any one of you help me out on this problem? Hello.
Yeah, I am seeing Dr. Radha Jina, madam. Madam, Dr. Radha Jina, madam, yes. Please again teach us. Madam, unmute yourself. Madam, unmute yourself.
Ma'am, please unmute yourself.
I think she is not listening us.
Oh. So, ma'am, Ragini, ma'am, you or Dr. Poonam Diksha, anybody, any of the panelists can help me out. What should I add? I have added ornithloxacin also twice a week, but still she's continued. And she says that she's taking the treatment regularly. She doesn't take it irregularly.
So, on ultrasound, what is her endometrial thickening, Amrita? Can I ask?
It was then 24 millimeters, and I have again asked her to go for an ultrasound. And now I have asked her to get a coagulation profile also done. Initially also a PT INR was done. INR was normal, but I didn't have the, like Gorakhpur doesn't have the facility of factor VIII, etc. So I didn't ask her.
That this girl might be having a polyp. If you are saying that it is 24, many a time the TS can miss a polyp. So okay. If 24 is really a very high thickness for a young girl, she yes. should be again evaluated yes. and you have to rule out any polyp or any other structural thing inside.
Okay. That is a possibility. And I think when we cannot do transvaginal, we can do a transperineal ultrasound to get a better picture.
Okay.
Yeah. It should be ruled out. Many a time they come up with the polyps and unless you remove these polyps or a small submucous myomas, the patient is not going to control. And it should be ruled out first before jumping to another treatment or another investigation.
What about her thyroid levels? TSH was normal?
Yes, again, it is now normal. Initially, it was a bit
initially, high. It was been, okay.
Yeah. So you have given already thyroid.
Thyroxin
I have
given.
And now her hemoglobin is okay.
Can you take some more questions?
So that is also there. She has so much estrogen in her body and her weight is 77 kg. So peripheral conversion is happening. We should also advise her weight loss because later on she can develop endometrial hyperplasia, endometriosis. These patients are very much prone to it.
Yeah, like I've asked her to do the lifestyle changes, but she is complaining that I bleed so much, that I'm taking, but she doesn't exercise. That is true. And her weight is going on increasing. Initially, it was not 77. It was lesser, 72 probably.
Amrita, can you ask Dr. Archana to take one or two questions from the wind up?
Dr. Archana Massey? Dr. Meenakshi Gupta, there? Are you there?
I don't think anybody.
Take the questions. Shall I take the questions, ma'am?
Yes, can I ask one question related to menstrual?
There are many questions. Ma'am, there are many questions here.
We can take only three questions. Choice is yours.
What about bone loss effect with prolonged use of GnRH analog? Dr. Ashima is there?
That is there
on. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Can you please answer that?
I answered it in the private chat. Mm-hmm. But yes,
for others,
what,
please.
What I also wrote in the chat box: all children during puberty, bone mass is one thing that all of us should be very careful about. So all girls should be emphasized
for having 500 mg calcium intake per day, which means at least 2 glasses of milk, or with eggs and other high protein, high calcium sources. Regarding vitamin D, the recommendation for prevention is still 600 to 800 IUs per day. So we are in the process of revising the recommendations for vitamin D during adolescence. But yes, what I do tell to my adolescent girls is they can comfortably take that 60,000 international units of vitamin D during their peak growth velocity years. So at least when they are gaining height, that vitamin D helps. And especially those who have delayed puberty, again, in these children, they are at a high high risk for bone mass loss because there has been no estrogen or other hormone for them, which is important for the bone mass accrual. So these children are also high risk for low bone mass, need to be supplemented with calcium and vitamin D, and same for those on GnRH analogs. So calcium vitamin D supplementation, irrespective of normal or delayed puberty, please, the message should be all adolescent girls to be supplemented with calcium and vitamin D both. Thank you, ma'am.
The next one was, if FSH is 20 in a 21-year-old unmarried girl with irregular periods, LH, TSH, prolactin normal, cycles are 40 to 60 days, what to do next?
Okay.
Ashima.
So basically,
this. Yes, ma'am. FSH is 20. So isolated FSH 20. So you said in your lecture that you shouldn't come to a diagnosis with a single. Predictor. Yes. So you should correlate it with the clinical findings as well.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
I am lost the question somewhere.
Any other question or we will wind up?
I have one question for Dr. Amrita probably. When we are talking of menstrual hygiene, can you share some experience of how well or how difficult is it to maintain hygiene with use of menstrual cups or tampons? Because these days the use of these agents is probably commoner and more fashionable in adolescent girls.
Yeah, one or two girls who have said that they are using or interested in cups. Most of them are using sanitary pads only. But tampons, we don't have a good experience because I have removed a few tampons from the vagina because of the girl has come up with the foul smelling discharge and excessive discharge, etc. And I was forced to see her vaginally because of the foul smell. And once I have removed a tampon, so I never advise the girls to use a tampon. They just forget in their fun time.
Can menstrual cup be used by girls who are not sexually active?
Sexually active?
Literature says yes, but practically, I think I don't see how.
Madam, even ACOG says no.
No.
ACOG also says no TVS on if she's not sexually active. Yep. It's very ACOG is very clear about it. Very for both menstrual cups and the TVS.
TVS.
Yes.
Thank you.
So thank you, everyone. I think we should wind up. It's already
somehow. I think one more important message is when we have those orientation. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, please.
Just to emphasize that we need to educate the girls in the school years also for this because they come demanding for information and experience for use of menstrual cups. So
yes,
that was very enlightening for me.
Right. We get a lot of girls who want to know about menstrual cups.
Then we tell them
about the POXO law.
Dr. Massey and Dr. Madhubala, thank you so much for this.
Thank you, Dr. Ragini. Thank you for having us stage this webinar. And
thank you, Dr. Ragini, for creating so many friends, ma'am. This is the next few fresh faces for us.
Thank you, Dr. Kachuru, Dr. Sampath, Dr. Poonam Dikshit, people who I'm meeting online for after a long time. And Dr. Ashima, you were wonderful. A special round of applause for you. You were so crystal clear. Yeah, I know everybody was appreciating your talks and your input. Thank you and thank you.
I enjoyed listening to all of you. It was
Madam Gina.
Thank you,
Madam Gina, for being here.
My internet connection was low, so I was disconnected for some time. It was such a wonderful webinar. I congratulate Ragini for selecting such a good topic, which is least understood by all of us. So today you have made it so clear. And I congratulate all the panelists. They were so good. And especially Ashima, you were too good. And you took so many questions without your turn. So you were too good, excellent. And everybody was very clear and very good. So thank you so much.
And thank you, Dr. Ashima, for such a short notice you came.
My pleasure. It was really delightful to be with all of you. Thank you, Dr. Chandan. Thank you, Dr. Ragini.
Thank you.
Most of the hard work was already done. Dr. Ragini had already done everything for me. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you, Jackson Pal. Thank you, Jackson Pal, for all the help. Dr. Deepika.
Thank you.
Madam Chandan, your talk was too good.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Very simple topic.
Great, you're pretty clear.
Yeah.
And thank you so much, ma'am.
And very much
unless
on time.
We know unless we know the normal, we can't understand the abnormal, ma'am.
Yeah.
This is all Dr. Ragini. Dr. Ragini's research, totally.
So good to meet everybody.
Yes.
Thank you. On behalf of Jackson Pal, I'd like to thank everybody. This is a small, short video.